So, about 8 videos ago, I said, in the next video, we'll look at a number of different stereo microphone techniques, so stay tuned.
Yeah, sorry about that.
To be honest, when I made that video, I really didn't have any idea what the next video would be. But as I started to think about it, it was looking like it was going to be a much bigger project than I had imagined. So I've decided to break this discussion on stereo into multiple videos, and today we're going to talk about the first considerations for choosing a stereo technique: stereo image versus mono compatibility. Now, before we can discuss mono compatibility, we need to discuss phase cancellation, or what happens when you sum together the outputs of two microphones.
Adding a second microphone will just make it louder, right?
Well, you tell me. Right now I'm talking on this lavalier microphone, and now I'll go step up to this podium.
Didn't get louder, did it? Not even an improvement, really. It just sounds like poo.
This is why we tell people who use both a lav mic and a podium mic to turn off the lav mic when they step up to the podium. No one ever listens, but we try. What was I talking about? Right, phase cancellation. So, why does this happen? Well, it's a simple matter of pressure waves competing against each other, and sound is pressure. Now, I really don't want to turn this into a physics lesson on the properties of sound propagation, so if you're brand new to this and you want to learn more about the basics of sound waves, check out the Crash Course video on sound. And then come back to this. Anyway, phase cancellation is a function of time arrival. That is, the time that a sound wave arrives at two different microphones. Suppose we take a tone generator and feed it through this speaker, and it's being picked up by these two microphones. The sound wave is going to reach mic A before it reaches mic B, but in the mixer they're going to be summed together. So let's record this and look at the sound waves on our DAW. Okay, here's the sound being picked up by mic A. And here's the sound from mic B. Now here's the two played back together. Notice that the sound level went down. When we zoom way in on the waveform, we can see why this happens. When mic A is playing back positive pressure, mic B is playing back negative pressure. The two added together results in phase cancellation.
Does that mean if we move mic B a couple more inches that it'll capture the wave so it'll add instead of subtract?
Yep. In our first recording, we basically had this going on. But move the second mic back a few inches, and they're both picking up a positive wave. I thought I fired that guy. The point is, at certain distances, some frequencies will add and others will cancel. But the problem is, the music that we're recording is made up of lots of different frequencies, all happening at the same time. So when you have a time arrival difference and you sum to mono, the quality and character of the final recording will be modified. So that brings us back to mono compatibility. And the bottom line is this: when someone listens to a stereo recording on a mono system, does it sound okay, or does it sound like poo?
Wait a minute. Who the heck is listening in mono, first of all? And if we're recording something that should be listened to in stereo, why should we care what it sounds like in mono?
Okay, let's tackle those one at a time. Who's listening in mono? Well, if you're listening on the little speaker on your phone, you are. Couldn't hear that, could ya? Second question, why should we care? Well, for the simple matter that we have no control over what system the consumer will be listening on. Mono playback is much more common than you might realize. Okay, so let's get into this, but first, quick stereo check.
Left, right, left, right, stereo.
Let's start with one of our most mono-compatible stereo techniques, coincident pair. This consists of two microphones at a 90-degree angle, with the capsules as close together as you can get them. Okay, so now we're listening to the coincident pair stereo technique. And the first thing you probably notice is the space around you. It sounds as if you're in this sound field, or in this space. And you can also hear the changes from left to right as I move around in this sound field. But now we're going to go to mono. And what you probably notice is how the sound field now collapses into the center. But because this is a very mono-compatible technique, the tone quality doesn't sound too terribly bad. That's because the path difference from my voice to the first capsule is almost the same as the distance from my voice to the second capsule. Let's go back and forth a couple of times. Now we're in stereo, and now we're in mono. Stereo, mono.
So when we listen to coincident pair in mono, it doesn't sound too bad, hence mono compatible. Let's hear a few musical examples. The problem that some people have with this technique is that it's not too stereophonically dramatic. It's not big and wide enough. So now let's listen to space pair.
Space pair is just like the name suggests, two microphones spaced apart, usually about 12 inches or more. And the first thing you probably notice is how much bigger and wider it sounds. And also the changes from left to right are much more exaggerated than they were with coincident pair. However, when we listen in mono, you will notice that there is a considerable difference in the tone quality than when we went to mono with coincident pair. Especially as I'm moving around, you can really hear that phase cancellation. That is because we have a time arrival issue. My voice reaches this capsule much sooner than it reaches this capsule. When they combine together, that creates destructive phase cancellation. Let's listen to a few musical examples on this one.
Okay, so let's circle back to the main objective of this video, stereo image versus mono compatibility. As you increase the distance between the mics, two things happen. The stereo image widens, but the possibility of destructive phase cancellation increases. So does that mean we shouldn't use space pair because it's not mono compatible? No, of course not. People use this method all the time, but it is important to be aware of what's going on.
And for the record, your recording subject probably isn't going to be moving.
So when you're setting up, switch back and forth between stereo and mono. If you don't have a mono switch on your listening system or interface, simply pan your left and right channels back to center.
If it sounds bad in mono, you may be able to improve the sound by moving the mics in or out a few inches.
Now at this point, you may be wondering if there's a stereo technique that has a great stereo image and is mono compatible. Yes, there is, and I'll cover that in our next video, and I promise I won't wait 18 months this time, so see you soon.